Geraldine for inviting me here, and thanks a million, Tom, for getting me into this mess. But I hope that you find this talk interesting, and I know it's certainly very topical at the moment. I was in Ballycroyd last Friday for the announcement that Kailasha were handing over their 4,200 hectares to the control of the National Park. So the whole area of Wyomathan is going to be under the auspices of the National Parks and Wildlife Service from now on. So hopefully that'll be a good thing. Just a little bit of background to why I chose the topic of rewilding, for which was the subject of my thesis just there during the summer. I've had a long-standing interest in mountains of Ireland and in hill walking, and especially in all things West Mayo. But I was really perplexed and confounded by the term rewilding when I first heard it in 2013. And especially because Wyomathan is such a unique and special place, really. And it's we're privileged that it's the one area, and the only area in Ireland, and it happens to be in our home county here, that has the official designation of a wilderness, you know, by EU standards. So, without further ado, anyway, I'll kick off and just let you know what I'm going to be talking about tonight. The my main objective really tonight is to just explain what the term means, or what I think it means, and how it should be applied in the case of Wyomathan. I'd also really appreciate lots of discussion and comments afterwards, if that's okay. I hope you're in a talking mode, because I'd be very interested to know what people take from the talk, and what you'd like to see happening in Wyomathan eventually. It's just a kind of a way of starting the conversation on rewilding, because it's a very long-term project. It's going to be going on for quite a while. There's going to be a conversion phase of 10 to 15 years while the National Parks and Wildlife Service set aside the area, if you like, as a wilderness area. The whole area is 110 square kilometres, so it's quite a big area. And it's important, I think, that it is managed and left to that at least a part of it is left to become self-willed. And I'll be explaining what this term means in a moment. Because rewilding is a bit like a sort of a catch-all term, like sustainable development and environmentalism were back in the 90s and in the early 2000s. It covers a multitude, really. So, in the second half of my talk, when I get on to the case studies that I looked at, the international comparators, I think it'll become clear what rewilding is and what it is not. And finally, then I'll get on to what rewilding means in the contemporary Irish context, using Wyomathan as a case study. And I'll finish up then with the observations of the future and the importance of legally securing wild spaces. So, when speaking about rewilding, you come up with various terms like wilderness and self-willed nature and ecological restoration and novel ecosystems. And I'll be giving examples of these throughout my talk. Self-willed nature is just letting nature take its course, and there's lots of examples of this all around us, because even on the motorways in Ireland at the moment, the long stretches of new motorway, there are long green stretches where they're being repopulated by raptors and wild birds, and this is a form of rewilding. Urban gardening is a kind of form of rewilding, or then ecological restoration is another term which is used, and the example that I use for that is Chernobyl, because there's a researcher in Trinity called Marcus Collier, who I consulted with during the course of my research, and he used the term novel ecosystem, actually, to describe what has happened in places like Chernobyl, where biodiversity has started to increase and the nature has begun to recover in what was once a wasteland. So, in summary, to maintain or increase biodiversity by reducing the impact of human interventions through the restoration of species and ecological processes. This is kind of what's common to all aspects of rewilding. So there are many examples. Now I will be talking in detail about four of them shortly, but the one that sort of gets a lot of publicity is the Oostvaldersplassen Reserve in the Netherlands, which was set up by an association called Rewilding Europe, headed up by a guy called Frans Vera. And it has become quite controversial, to say the least. And it has a lot of opponents in other wildlife experts or wildland experts around the world who think it's something akin to a safari park or a wild zoo, an open zoo. Yellowstone National Park is often cited as well by authors like George Monbiot, where something called a trophic cascade takes place, where they introduce megafauna to the area, like they reintroduced the wolves into Yellowstone National Park, which then preyed upon the deer, and this had an impact right down through the strata of wildlife in the park. And but a lot of the examples that I'm giving you here, they were kind of, they're what are called anthropocentrically orientated, and they're not nature driven. They're not really putting nature first. They're just being set up as for ecotourism benefits and to make money out of them. So the paradox of protecting nature and allowing open access is something that I will discuss as well throughout the talk. But the term rewilding only entered the dictionary in 2011, which is very, very recent. And when it was first formulated, it meant releasing captive animals into the wild. But soon the definition expanded to describe the reintroduction of animal and plant species to habitats from which they had been excised. Some people defined it as the rehabilitation of entire ecosystems, a restoration of wilderness, and others applied it to human life, a wilding of people and their cultures. But the rewilding of natural ecosystems that most fascinates people like George Monbiot, who wrote Feral in 2013, is not an attempt to restore them to any prior state, but to permit ecological processes to resume. And this is something that should be borne in mind, I think, in when we come to look at why Nathan itself. That it's there's a bit of an argument going on as to whether it's an ecological restoration project or a rewilding project. And this is something that I hope will be clear by the time I'm finished tonight. The topic of rewilding has also generated much debate in academic literature since it was first coined in the US in the early 1990s. And according to Dolly Jorgensen in 2014, rewilding as a specific scientific term has its beginnings as a reference to the Wildlands Project in North America, which was founded in 1991. And it aimed to create core wilderness areas right across the North American continent, which would be without human activity, and that would be connected by corridors to allow the wildlife to roam freely between the different areas. So Pryor and Ward then, in a paper last year, 2016, they respond to and challenge Jorgensen's criticisms of the concept of rewilding by arguing that non-human autonomy, or self-willed nature, which is the key term that I want to get across, is at the core of all rewilding. And secondly, they challenge Jorgensen's broad claim that sees the collapse of rewilding into anti-human wilderness management, using the counter-argument of the dynamic human-non-human entanglements embedded within rewilding practices, and equating rewilding as a wild experiment. This is something that has been taken up by some Irish authors recently as well, notably Páraic Fogarty, whose book Whittled Away was published this year. He was former chairman of the Irish Wildlife Trust, and he actually defines what's happening in wildlife as a wild experiment. That's kind of the way he looks upon it. Then other researchers in Copenhagen, Lucas Brabe and their team, said that restoration of ecosystems through the reintroduction of species, people should exercise caution when rewilding. And a North American author, Carey, in 2016, citing a group called Rewilding Europe, that I referred to earlier, wrote that they were reintroducing European...
Sorry.
Getting back to Carey and his paper, the Rewilding Europe, that group, they were reintroducing European bison, which went extinct in the wild in 1927, to the southern Carpathians and other locations. He goes on to state that the group hopes to rewild 1 million hectares by 2022 for the benefit of nature and people, helped in part by the abandonment of farmland. Now, the goals include restoring grasslands and ecosystem functions, including predation, and creating a rural tourist economy. So again, it's quite tourism driven. But Carey, then, when he mentions the non-profit Rewilding Britain, which is different, which was launched by George Monbiot and Mark Fisher of Self-Willed Land, Mark Fisher is strongly opposed to the aims and actions of Rewilding Europe, and he's openly critical of that organisation. Because Rewilding Britain plans to bring back such species as lynx, beaver and wolves, maintaining that reintroducing predators to the Scottish Highlands, for example, would knock back the deer population, allowing trees to rebound and boosting biodiversity. So basically they're trying to mimic what happened in Yellowstone Park in the States. So just to kind of summarise my findings from my literature survey, just the direction that rewilding is going, based on academic literature, the general consensus is probably the three points here, that more scientific research is required, including managed experiments and studies of areas of inadvertent change. So I suppose taking my cue from that, I looked at numerous areas in which rewilding experiments have been conducted around the world, and in a moment I'll discuss each of those four in turn. And in order to find some suitable comparative precedents for Wyandotheca, the element of self-willed land with minimum human involvement I feel will be a significant factor. However, all of the areas, whether they're national or state or private parks, inevitably have involved or continue to require some degree of human management, usually for sound scientific and recreational reasons. So I suppose we probably should be grateful that at least the people that have been managing Ballycroy National Park up to now, as in the National Parks and Wildlife Service, will continue to be the managers of the Wyandotheca area. The second point is greater objective assessment of the economic benefits of rewilding and the ecological impacts need to be carried out. And this is especially true in the case of Wyandotheca, which I'll discuss shortly, because while the economic benefits of Wyandotheca have already been estimated by environmental economists, one should critically assess their findings and include the wider sociological, philosophical and physiological benefits that can potentially accrue in the future. Advocates of rewilding recognise that value is attached to cultural landscapes and that rewilding can conflict with prevalent and powerful institutions and cultural norms. In other words, rewilding will not be appropriate everywhere and should be a complement to other forms of conservation management. There is potential for serious conflict if attempts are made to impose rewilding against the will of public groups, even if there are no legal reasons why this should not be done. It's therefore critical to involve local and national interest groups in discussions on its future application. It is also critical to hold public awareness meetings such as this one, I suppose, that we're having tonight. And I would advocate that it would be important to hold a lot of public discussion in the various townlands and villages and areas around Ballycroy National Park, as in, Newport, Tomaranny, and Ballycroy and Bangor areas. But that's, as I said, that's what I'd like to discuss with everyone afterwards, if that's okay. So moving on to the four case studies that I looked at. The first one is Baxter State Park in Maine, USA. The second one is the Picos de Europa National Park in northern Spain. The third one is Wild Innerdale in the Lake District National Park in Cumbria, the UK. And the fourth one is Knockmura Discovery Park in Offaly. So, in 1931, former state governor of the state of Maine, Percival Baxter, he donated about 6,000 acres of land to the state of Maine in northeastern USA on condition that it is kept forever wild. The area includes the state's highest peak, Mount Katahdin, and over subsequent years until 1962, Governor Baxter made additional purchases, and since then, the Baxter State Park has expanded to the estimated 215,000 acres that it is today. The park is a year-round destination for outdoor enthusiasts, run by a permanent staff of 22, that swells to 61 in the summer. Now, about 75% of Baxter State Park is managed as a wildlife sanctuary, and another 40% then was designated by Governor Baxter to be managed as a scientific forest management area. In addition to this, then another 25% of these areas overlap, so it's over 100%. The park is open to hunting and trapping, with the exception that moose hunting is prohibited in the park. Now, Baxter left a trust of nearly $7 million to ensure that park managers would have sufficient funds to maintain the park without ever having to compete for Maine taxpayers' dollars from the general fund account. So, he also stipulated that sole governing authority regarding the park and management would be a group of three public officials, namely the Commissioner of Maine Inland Fisheries and Wildlife, the Director of the Maine State Forest Services, and the Attorney General. The individuals holding these three positions in Maine comprise the Baxter State Park Authority, and as such are responsible for protecting the natural resources and upholding the conditions set forth in Governor Baxter's Deeds of Trust. Park managers also work closely with Baxter State Park Advisory, a committee of 15 citizens dedicated to examining issues and supporting the stewardship of the authority. Baxter's philosophy was very much in keeping with the US 1964 Wilderness Act that states, a wilderness is an area where the earth and its community of life are untrammeled by man, where man himself is a visitor who does not remain. In his deeds of trust, Baxter stipulated that the park shall forever be retained and used for state forest, public park, and recreational purposes, shall forever be kept and remain in the natural wild state, and shall forever be kept and remain as a sanctuary for beasts and birds. Now, while Baxter State Park is about 8 times the size of the area currently designated as Wild Nathan, and the human resources at their disposal far exceeds those of the Irish National Parks and Wildlife Service, I think, nonetheless, it's an excellent model for the Wild Nathan Project team to aspire to. By putting nature first and humans second, the quality of the wilderness experience is enhanced and the feeling of remoteness is retained. Baxter State Park was originally conceived as a park for those who love nature and are willing to walk and make an effort to get close to nature. Unlike many national parks in the US and elsewhere, the features and diversity of Baxter State Park are best experienced on foot. And I would contend that Wild Nathan is best experienced on foot as well. Ultimately, I would argue that this is the philosophy that should be adopted when the process of rewilding Wild Nathan has been completed. As little as possible by way of vehicular access to the newly rewilded wilderness area should be permitted, and walking trails only should be used. In effect, this is how Ballycroy National Park has been managed up to now, so therefore no major changes in the management policy are envisaged, I would hope. The challenges for wilderness in a European context include designations such as special areas of conservation, which oblige landowners to manage and to maintain the standards of the protected habitats of species. And this is a dilemma for wilderness managers who, in the opinion of some, should only be managing human intervention. When asked what his advice was on wilderness, Jensen Bissell, the director of Baxter State Park Wilderness, this is in 2013, he replied that man should resist the temptation of thinking he can always improve things. So, this philosophy of improvement, and I'll just digress ever so slightly here if I may, the philosophy of improvement has strong resonances in Ireland, where traditionally all land would have been evaluated in terms of its potential productivity, and agrarians sought to reclaim poor land and render it arable. But this was an instrumentalist view of nature, where nature is to be dominated. It's a colonial approach, that nature is there to be manipulated and exploited. But thankfully, wilderness is viewed much differently today. With the rise in ecotourism in the past decade, the whole paradigm has shifted to a much more positive view of wild landscapes and wilderness areas, and where spending more time in nature leads to better health. We just need to strike the proper balance regarding access management, which will be a challenge for the wilderness managers of the future. So getting back on track, the second area that I looked at was Los Picos de Europa in northern Spain. Now this was declared a national park in 1918, the very first one to be established in Spain. So in 1995 it was extended to cover 646 square kilometres. So it's roughly six times the size of Wildnathan and Crescent. But in 2003, UNESCO approved biosphere reserve status, for the national park. And Picos de Europa is one of several biosphere reserves in the Cantabrian Mountains, which are being integrated into a super reserve to be known as Gran Cantabrica. So though it's six times the size of the Wildnathan Wilderness Area, Los Picos has some commonality with the area and offers some valuable insights into rewilding. According to Corey Fogarty, research into the origins of our wildlife revealed even more obscure connections between Ireland and Spain. DNA and other analysis show that post-Ice Age colonisation of a number of species of plants and animals, from badgers and spotted slugs to the Cantabrian heath shrub, can be traced not to Britain, as might be expected, but to the Iberian Peninsula. So Fogarty describes what makes the Picos so distinctive and unique to Spain, is that the big animals that disappeared from Ireland long ago, bears, wolves and wild cats, lynx and wild boar. And he speculates whether this could lead to the reintroduction of wolves somewhere like Mayo and the Wildnathan Wilderness Area. Well, this is extremely unlikely, in my opinion, because the preferred form of rewilding in Mayo is not to introduce apex food chain predators at any time in the near future, because in the first place, the deer population is not at a sufficient level to merit the reintroduction of a deer predator, and secondly, there'd be widespread opposition, I'm sure, from the adjacent farming community. And thirdly, the area is too small to accommodate wolf packs in any number. But mention of reintroduction of wolves, bears, wild boars or lynx to Ireland can result in the sensationalising and trivialising of the whole process of rewilding in an Irish context. And this is problematic and tends to complicate the debate. This is reverting back too far in ecological or revolutionary time, and in restoration solely for anthropogenic reasons and for the tourism potential. It's contrary to Baxter's belief that nature should come first and recreation second. And it's not in tandem with self-willed land advocates either, like Mark Fisher, who view these large carnivore reintroductions as something akin to manufactured safari parks or open zoos. So the third area is Wild Enerdale. Wild Enerdale is a remote Cumbrian valley on the western fringes of the UK's Lake District National Park. And it's a partnership between the Forestry Commission in England, the National Trust, and a water company called United Utilities. It was established in 2003. It's less than half the size of Wildnathan, but it's nonetheless a worthy comparator. And it was visited by the Wildnathan project team back in 2013, when the whole notion of the Wildnathan was first launched and publicly announced. I should mention perhaps that it was originally the brainchild of Bill Murphy, who was formerly the recreation director with Caltech. And Bill is still very much involved as a recreation consultant, with freelance consultant now, and he's currently actually pursuing a master's in UCD on wilderness. So with a history of sheep-battered fells and conifer slums, that's a quote, it featured prominently in a wilderness conference that was held in Westport in 2013, organised by Bill Murphy. And Michael Viney wrote a piece on it in the Irish Times, saying that the manager, the then manager of Ennerdale, Gareth Browning, he was predicting that he'd probably say that we're not producing timber here now, we're producing wildness. So that kind of has echoes for the Caltia forestry in the Nathan Beggs as well, that they're not producing timber anymore, they're going to set it aside as a wilderness. However, one of the keynote speakers at the same conference in 2013, a man I mentioned already, Mark Fisher, at that time he was an advocate of Wild Ennerdale, but within 1 year he had changed his mind about the project, calling it, quote, the most over-promoted but critically unscrutinised restoration project in England. And he reported that the only conifers that were replaced by native broadleaves were being fenced in to protect them from an overabundance of grazing cattle. So by April 2015, Fisher was thoroughly sickened and stated that there's nothing wild about Ennerdale now, except the desperate emotions that it raises in me, and the crushing disappointment that this publicly owned land will no longer be fulfilling any aspirations for wildness. So those fairly strongly held and well-expressed views provide additional insights into the direction the Wild Nathan project may or may not take in the future. And I hope at this point what's beginning to emerge is the idea that rewilding, what it is and what it should not be in our case. And I just feel it's perhaps time to let all of nature have a voice and become self-willed. I would contend that Wild Ennerdale is not a suitable role model for Wild Nathan and will not be regarded as one. But nonetheless, I've included it here as an example of what not to do when re-engineering Wild Nathan into a self-willed landscape. Wild Ennerdale, though, continues to be promoted by the organisation Rewilding Britain and was considered at one time a potential site for the reintroduction of lynx to England. But this idea has now been dropped in favour of the Kielder Nature Reserve in Northumberland, and the local families are reported to be at odds over the proposal. So the fourth and final area that I looked at was the Loch Urrie Discovery Park, and I visited this during the summer. Now, this I would call it an Irish rewilding success story, though it hasn't formally been called that. With a total area of just 2,257 hectares, Loch Urrie Discovery Park is only about one-fifth the size of Wild Nathan. In the early 1990s, this was a Bordemona peat-harvesting wasteland. And today, it boasts a biodiversity of flora and fauna to rival any of our national parks. It's what Marcus Collier would call a novel ecosystem that contains huge diverse species where nature has re-established itself by just being left alone following years of human exploitation and despoilation. However, it's not the full story to claim that it was completely untrammelled by man in the intervening rewilding period that brought it to what it is today. Loch Urrie Discovery Park was officially opened in October 2014. And in 1996, Bordemona had initially intended to plant conifers on the site. But when this failed, the Bora Parklands Group was formed by workers in the company to develop new approaches to using the land. So after turning off the water pumps, which had allowed machinery to work with peat, large areas were flooded, forming new lakes and wetlands. New communities of plants and animals emerged, from birch woodlands to expanses of bog cotton, and there was no attempt to recreate what had been there, probably an impossible task in any event, and no attempt was made to impose a vision of what it should look like. Bordemona referred to the process as rehabilitation, so that's another term. Since the 1990s, Bordemona has been actively carrying out research into rehabilitation of cutaway bogs for the purposes of promoting biodiversity. And this has resulted in an extensive network of cutaway bogs with a range of established habitats. But pride of place goes to Loch Urrie, because since its inception, the local people, or people that were working for Bordemona, have been at the heart of the plans for the Lochbuie Discovery Park, as it is now called. And for all intents and purposes, the land was allowed to become self-willed after an initial phase of rewilding. This, then, in essence, is an Irish rewilding success story. And there, in my opinion, there are aspects of it that could be emulated in Wildnafa. So, to summarise, the short selection of places from around the world illustrates the concept of rewilding in different regions, whether the practice has been formally regarded as such or not. Although the word rewilding had not been invented when Baxter State Park and Higgins de Europa National Park were established, nonetheless, the current missions and policies in these parks are in tandem with recognised and respected wilderness principles. Given their scale, Baxter State Park and the Pecos best fulfil John Muir's philosophy of going it alone on a self-sufficient backpacking expedition, as does Wildnafa. Wild Innerdale and Lochbuie are certainly much more tamer experiences, but it is the biodiversity aspect of Lochbuie that is important for Wildnafa to emulate. In contrast, current practices in Wild Innerdale, largely due to overmanagement and human interference, are not in keeping with the self-willed nature aspect of rewilding that has been made manifest in Lochbuie. So it's therefore the positive aspects of Baxter State Park, Pecos and Lochbuie that will provide the greatest influence upon the rewilding of Wildnafa, whereas Wild Innerdale will be cited as an example to avoid. So moving closer to home, I'd like to turn now your attention to the fourth and final part of my presentation tonight, and that's the Wildnafa Wilderness Project itself. Just to put the area into context to the rest of the country, let's first take a look at Ireland's national parks and how Ballycroy compares with the other five. Well the Minister made a great play that it was it was now much bigger than Killarney. It's actually over 50 square kilometres bigger than Killarney National Park at 157. But it was always the third largest national park in the country anyway. It is our newest and youngest national park. It was only established in 1998, whereas Killarney was set up in 1932. So the book that I referred to earlier, Whittled Away by Pádraig Fogarty. Pádraig Fogarty did a study on between 2013 and 2016. He did a study on all five, excluding Ballycroy, actually, as it happened. But he found that only one of the other five, the Burren, and I think he was actually looking at the Greater Burren area rather than just the 15 square kilometres of Burren National Park. He was looking at the Greater Burren area. He felt that only the Burren came close to what could be described as well managed. Killarney still has a lot going for it, but needs urgent intervention. In Connemara, Wicklow and Glenveagh, pretty places near the car parks are kept photogenic, but beyond that, things have mostly gone to rot, which is not good news. As for being managed for their characteristic species and ecosystems, as per the IUCN Category 2 National Parks definition, they don't even come close. Ballycroy National Park, which includes the Eoin Duff Nathan Special Area of Conservation and Special Protection Area, is also part of the Natura 2000 network, whereby all EU states are obliged to protect and manage habitats of scientific interest, an immediate dilemma for the development of a free-willed landscape. But just to give you a whistle-stop tour of this, as of last Friday, National Parks and Wildlife Service fully controlled 100% of the park, the project. And you all know where it is, I presume, but it takes up that part of Mayo. This, I don't know how clear that is, but that's actually the full area of the park, which is the combined, what was formerly National Parks and Wildlife plus Cleisha, and the Wildnafa concept plan is shown in this slide here. So, the project itself will be in two phases. The first phase, the transition phase or the conversion phase, will take about 10 to 15 years. That's preparing the landscape. and ecology that are in place that will be allowed after the 15-year phase, it'll enter the self-will phase or the rewilding phase proper. It actually, as it stands, the whole area meets EU wilderness guidelines on size and diversity and the absence of humans. So at present, the project is at a very early stage. It's a mere 4 years on from its official launch in 2013. But clearly, the early indications are that Wild Nathan already meets many of the current agreed international guidelines for a wilderness area as decreed by the EU. The designated area set aside is big enough. The topography and biodiversity are varied and interesting, and there is little or no human habitation on the site. Therefore, the rewilding project goals for the next 10 to 12 years should be largely in line with the six objectives recommended in the 2011 feasibility report, as outlined here. And these were that the core area should be set aside as a candidate wilderness with a view to making it free from human intervention post 2030. Local and national consultation should be carried out on the concept of wilderness designation. An easement should be given by Kelsha to a third party to support the Wild Nathan designation. And a management group should be established to develop a management and re-engineering programme for the site. Now, I understand there is actually a project steering group established, and they do hold meetings periodically to progress the plan. And also, there's a consultancy firm have been commissioned to work with the National Parks and Wildlife to draw the elements of the conversion plan. But that hasn't become publicly available yet. The buffer zone that I showed you in the previous map should be managed to support the wilderness designation. So, just returning just to Fogarty's comments again, he actually writes quite a lot on Ballycroy National Park because he actually singles out Ballycroy National Park for special consideration because, quote, it's at the centre of a unique wilderness experiment, which is exciting, and it's intended to allow natural forces to reassert themselves and give visitors an opportunity to enjoy a unique outdoor wilderness experience. He also says that the paradox is that the Burren National Park has succeeded across the whole landscape, not just within the boundaries of the small national park. And he argues that what if our national parks were managed not as mere tourist attractions as they are now, but for their wildlife and landscape value? If the lessons learned at the Burren were to be replicated across the other five regions mentioned and their wider cultural hinterlands, there would be immense dividends both economically and ecologically. Now, there are aspects of what's happening in the Burren, like the Burren Bureau Trust and other organisations that work within the Burren area. Because I actually live in Ennis, and so I get to visit the Burren quite often, and I'm a member of the Burren Bureau Trust. And I think there are certainly a lot of positive learnings that could be adapted from the approach used in the Burren if they were applied in the case of Wild Nathan. But there's a lot of challenges to be overcome to make Wild Nathan a success. And in a recent paper published just late last year in the Australian Journal of Nature New South Wales, Bill Murphy, a freelance recreation consultant that I spoke about earlier, clearly stated that the Wild Nathan project is not restoration. So Murphy is adamant about that. And he says that over the next 15 years, a transition plan will reverse some of the human interventions that have modified the landscape. In effect, this is a rewilding process, the necessary transition phase through which Wild Nathan must pass to becoming a self-willed natural wilderness. At present, the forest consists primarily of lodgepole pine and other species like Sitka spruce. Now, Dennis Strong, who's the regional manager for the National Parks and Wildlife Service, was quoted in the Times by Laura Siggins last Saturday that in saying that the rewilding of areas managed by Kelsha would involve replacing coniferous with deciduous trees in some parts, but key specimens such as mature Monterey pine would be kept. So it looks as if Genesis plans, or at least NPWS's plans for Wiley Nathan, are similar to the way things were proceeding 4 years ago. And but I would argue that the rewilding process in this case does include elements of restriction, albeit while in transition to becoming self-willed. Now, some parts of the forest in the Nathan Beg area have already been restored to blanket bogland, and under an EU Life project regulated by the Forest Service, there is a biodiversity plan that the company must adhere to in the area, including Wild Nathan. In North Mayo, rewilding should not exclude people. In fact, I would argue that the rewilding of the Wild Nathan wilderness will only be successful by including people. And there's ample opportunity to build on the successes achieved in the Burn and in Lochbourne and Baxter State Park to make this project a success. One challenge that confronts the project team right now is whether to continue to eradicate the invasive rhododendron ponticum, as they are obliged to under current EU directives, or to leave it. And another challenge will be to secure some form of legal status for the area to be set aside, be that under IUCN, EU or national legislation. Now, it's my understanding that all of the national parks in the country are governed by a certain amount of legislation, but the only area in the country that has specific legislation applied to it is the Bourne Vincent National Park, part of the Killarney National Park. And there was actually a law enacted back in 1932 when this area was donated to the state by the American owners at the time, the Bourne Vincent family. And it was set then in stone, if you like, at the time, that it couldn't be interfered with in any way and would be left as a wild area, wild park. So I feel that there's justification for drawing up some legislation to govern what the wild Nathan area as well. Because as Michael Viney is quoted as saying, our special landscapes deserve a policy. And he wrote this back in 1999 in a letter to the same paper then on the 5th of August last year. Bill Murphy wrote that the Wild Nathan wilderness has no legal status and will continue to be under threat from potential future development, be that telecom masts or power lines or forestry or wind farms or inappropriate visitor facilities. So giving legal status to the Wild Nathan wilderness will protect this landscape as an area where nature prevails and human influence is minimal. So one of the key challenges will be how to influence the EU to update existing draft guidelines in order to include modified landscapes such as the Wild Nathan Wilderness Project in its formal criteria of designated areas. So in order to complete an evaluation of the potential for rewilding the Wild Nathan Wilderness area in County Mayo, I completed a critical analysis, and the location of the area adjacent to the Wild Atlantic Way driving route is seen as an asset because it increases exposure to the park and raises the profile of the Wild Nathan area within it. And the Western Way long distance walking route, which runs through part of the Nathan Forest and alongside the Wild Nathan section of Ballycroy National Park, reveals the wilderness area to walkers and trekkers who might not otherwise have been aware of its existence. So, also, the presence of the internationally known Bangor Trail within the area is another positive feature of the recreational amenities that Ballycroy National Park currently offers walkers interested in demanding long-distance walks, and will remain a complementary asset of Wild Nathan. There, as many of you will know, there are published guidebooks on both the Western Way and the Bangor Trail. But the Memorandum of Understanding, which was drawn up in 2013 between National Parks and Wildlife Service and Quenche, which is probably going to be replaced now by, as I said, it's going to be superseded by National Park and Wildlife legislation. I would have seen that as a challenge because it's not very strong legally. It's just a fairly soft agreement. But the lack of government will to copper fasten the MOU and introduce legislation to strengthen it is a concern. Also, the lack of understanding of the nature of the project and some contention over what rewilding is could also be a challenge, and that's why I'm glad that we're starting a conversation tonight. The constrictions on pleasure through the Forestry Service regulations is no longer, I suppose, applicable, and the lack of funding for awareness and public education The lack of information in the public domain is another challenge. The possibilities, though, see, one of the most compelling justifications, really, for the whole rewilding project comes from Mark Fisher, whom I spoke about earlier. He's a research fellow at the Wildland Research Institute in Leeds, and that institute was commissioned by the EU to draw up guidelines on wilderness for the EU. So I feel that his credentials are pretty good. So therefore, what he has said, and he has blogged about Wyanathan, the Wyanathan project is entirely synonymous with an Irish wilderness. The acceptance of what has gone before, the phased removal of human management, confidence in a process of naturalisation, and a trajectory to a potential natural vegetation, albeit a new future natural vegetation. But above all, though, it is the strong linking of human fulfilment to an experience of this future natural wilderness and the freedoms that brings, which must be an important lesson for, and he's addressing this to the public forest estate in Britain, but also have currency in the whole of Northwest Europe. In other words, not only is Wyanathan unique and special to Ireland, but it could be a precedent for future rewilding projects in Europe and worldwide. The potential for recreation and outdoor education as a learning landscape, like the burn is used, is also a possibility. The fact that the political representative for the region is now Minister for Rural and Community Affairs is already bearing a bit of fruit or having an impact. The agreement that they've drawn with Forge Ireland and Mayo County Council could help with in relation to funding, because this is probably badly wanted. We don't have, unfortunately, we don't seem to have too many philanthropists like Baxter in Maine coming up and giving plenty of money to our national parks or our wild areas. But there is a possibility that Wyanathan could be twinned with Baxter State Park, and for the whole of West Mayo to become an outdoor recreational hub. So what then does the future hold for us? Well, the legal position. I'll just give you one more quote, but this is from Alan Craig, who was the director of DOPIS, who was over the National Parks and Wildlife Service back in 2001. And he wrote a paper for the Royal Irish Academy, and he said that the legal position of all the national parks is unsatisfactory by international standards. So basically, he was agreeing back in 2001 with what Fogarty was writing in 2016, that there's no general national parks legislation, although detailed preparatory work has been carried out for such legislation. Only the Bourne Vincent Memorial Park, now part of Killarney National Park, Montecarlo, was established as a specific act. And I apologise for repeating this, but this is both unique and extraordinary, because firstly in that the act dates back to 1932 and no specific legislation has been enacted since then pertaining to any of Ireland's national parks. It is significant that because Bourne Vincent Memorial Park was bequeathed to the state by a North American donor, legislation akin to that in force in the US national parks was applied at the time, and the parklands were handed over to the Irish state. So I see that really as kind of, you know, one of the biggest concerns for the future. Now, as well as that, I've listed a number of issues there that I'll let you read through them yourselves. But just to conclude for now, the recent achievement of international dark sky status that was awarded to Wyanathan Wilderness is another significant testament to its wildness and increases the uniqueness and international awareness of the park. And to paraphrase Georgia, who is here with us tonight, at the launch of the Dark Sky Project, when she said that the new park gives humanity the opportunity to celebrate the wonder of darkness. Well, I would say that the Wyanathan gives humanity the opportunity to celebrate the wonder of wilderness. So Wyanathan is an ecologically exciting project and has great potential to become a truly wild ecosystem that people can spend time in and really connect with nature at its best. The experience of true wilderness that it offers is unrivaled in Ireland, and Wyanathan can become the blueprint for all future wilderness experiments in Europe and elsewhere. Thank you.
getting there. Give me a chance. Thank you, Dan. That was very informative. I wish I would do a chance up here walks when you got some of those pictures. I would print across them, but that's a different story. There's photographers here, there's Peter.